Good morning, and welcome to the online worship service for Batesville Presbyterian Church on this 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. Well, as followers of Jesus, our Savior calls us each day to prepare our lives of faith for those times of crisis and struggle that confront us unexpectedly as we wait for His coming again into our midst. Well, in today's scripture passage from the Gospel of Matthew, Christ shows us just how vigilant we must be in preparing our spiritual lives for these times of testing while engaging faithfully in the work of God's kingdom until Christ returns. Well, this morning in my message entitled Fill Up Those Lamps, we will explore the importance of this preparation for our own lives as we examine our life of faith from the perspective of the 10 bridesmaids in today's gospel reading. Let us prepare our hearts and minds now to hear the proclamation of God's word for our lives, beginning with the reading of Holy Scripture. And as we open the pages of God's living word for our lives, we turn again this week to the Gospel of Matthew and one of our Savior's most misunderstood parables found in the Gospels, the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. In this parable that's found only in Matthew, our Savior tells the story of 10 bridesmaids who, according to wedding tradition in the first century Jewish culture, are waiting to light the way for the bridegroom. While 5 of the bridesmaids have prepared well for this event by filling their lamps with enough oil and then some, the 5 others are not ready. They're not ready for any type of delay or crisis that may come their way. As a result, these 5 bridesmaids, what Christ calls the 5 foolish bridesmaids, are caught unprepared and miss out on the opportunity to attend the glorious wedding banquet. Well, through this story, Jesus challenges each of us, you and me, to be prepared for those unexpected moments of struggle and disappointment in our lives by keeping our spiritual lamps burning brightly with a steady and unwavering faith in Christ, the true source of our joy and our strength. If you'd like to follow along, the reading is from the 25th chapter of Matthew, verses 1 through 13. May the Holy Spirit transform these words on a page into life-giving food for our very souls as we listen now to the reading of God's living word. Jesus said, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.' Then all the bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You'd better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore,' says Jesus, 'for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Patient and ever-present God, it is so easy to let the light of our spiritual lamps burn out when we work so hard to make ends meet and our lives are stretched so thin. It seems like in the rush of our 24/7 world, our lives of faith are pushed to the back burner and soon lose their flame in the ever-swirling whirlwind of life. Reignite your flame of faith in our hearts and souls, we pray, loving Lord, and empower us through your Spirit with a deep desire to prepare our lives for those times of difficulty and testing as we fill our lamps to overflowing with the radiant faith of our Savior, so all may see Christ in us, even this very day. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. At one time or another in our Christian lives, I'm sure many of us have heard this rather striking parable of our Savior interpreted in such a way that sets off alarms in our minds. And no matter how hard we try, we just can't turn them off. You know what I mean? It's those signals of uncontrollable fear, like the ones created by the fictional Left Behind series, which penetrate the very depths of our hearts and souls once the verdict is announced that some individuals have received a ticket to heaven, while others are destined for a place even hotter than Death Valley, California. In this traditional understanding of the parable, Jesus is proclaiming harsh words of judgment against those individuals who are not prepared for his second coming and as a result miss out forever on the long-awaited opportunity to step through door number 3 and into the heavenly kingdom of God. Without a doubt, this interpretive approach can definitely strike the fear of God into you from the top of your head to the bottom of your toes. And it certainly is one way of interpreting the parable, but it is definitely not the only way. So today I would like for us to look at this story through a new set of lenses. For as your pastor, I don't believe our Savior's reason for telling the parable was to scare people into submission with a who's in or who's out theology. No, that's not how our God of love works. As we begin this morning to explore other possible interpretations, let's first establish the storyline and the players for this unique drama that's offered only in Matthew's Gospel. In the parable, our setting is a traditional Jewish wedding, and the actresses, in this case, are 10 bridesmaids. And as was the custom in first century, these maidens are responsible for lighting the pathway once the groom arrives to pick up the bride and take her to his home, where a ceremony and an extended banquet are planned for several days. Well, so far it's just an ordinary first century wedding with no real surprises for the wedding party or the guests. But that's about ready to change. For in the very next verse, Jesus informs us that out of the 10 bridesmaids, 5 are wise and the other half are foolish. And the difference has nothing to do with a heavy dose of partying the night before. Instead, it rests simply with the amount of oil that the wedding attendants have on hand for their lamps. As the story goes, the groom was delayed in arriving to pick up the bride, and soon all the bridesmaids became sleepy and quickly dozed off as their lamps burn away into the night. When the groom finally arrives at midnight, the wise maidens have extra oil to refill their lamps, while the foolish ones were faced with the impossible task of locating more fuel at midnight, and in the end they find themselves locked out of the wedding festivities. Doesn't seem quite fair, does it? I mean, really, expecting those 5 bridesmaids to locate a dealer that's open at midnight? And good luck finding extra oil at the 24-hour convenience store down the street. It just won't happen. Plus, did you happen to notice that these 5 out-of-luck bridesmaids ask the other bridesmaids in a kind way for some of their extra fuel? And these fair-weather friends, well, they refused. Wow. Wow, what a rotten deal. Oh, and by the way, did you catch that first verse of this story when Jesus tells us that the kingdom of heaven is like this? The kingdom of heaven is just like this story in the parable. No wonder many preachers interpret this parable the way that they do. It's just an easier explanation to accept. The wise bridesmaids represent believers who make it into heaven, while the foolish ones include all the rest who are sent packing to the hottest climate imaginable for a very, very long time. Now, for those who hold to this interpretation, I'll be the first to agree with them that this parable is a call to faithful living as committed disciples of Jesus Christ. Through this story, I believe our Savior is calling each of us to live lives of faith, love, and mercy that exemplify the righteousness and prepare us for the kingdom of God. But as far as getting locked out of the kingdom of heaven, well, that's sort of where I draw the line. For you see, my friends, we don't dedicate our lives as disciples and fill our lamps because we're scared to death we'll be locked out of heaven. No, we don't. We commit our lives completely to Christ because we know that our future rests securely in the hands of a God who loves us unconditionally, no strings attached, and has claimed us as his very own from the very beginning. As the Apostle Paul reminds all believers in his letter to the Christians in Thessalonica, "You are children of the light," says Paul, "and God has destined us for obtaining salvation through Jesus Christ. And since we are children of the light," Paul assures us that we are already living into God's future, bound together as believers in the faith, hope, and love of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Well, along with obscuring the real reason for our commitment as disciples, this interpretation also misses the mark on at least one other critical aspect of the story, the source of the fuel in our spiritual lamps. Beloved, the oil in our lamps is not a commodity. It's not a commodity that can be traded or swapped from one person to another, or a reserve which can be stockpiled for us by someone else. No, when all is said and done, the spiritual development of our lives is a process that only we can do for ourselves through the power of the Holy Spirit. No one can provide that to us. So what are the ingredients of this spiritual oil, you ask? Well, it includes a deep and abiding faith, as well as a steadfast peace, perseverance, and spiritual strength that remain constant in the midst of the storm while shining bright for Christ every moment of every day. And replenishing this spiritual fuel is no easy task. It requires a daily discipline of prayer, Bible study, and meditation on our part, as well as loving service to those in need whose paths we cross daily. Loving service, dedication, Bible study, meditation. That's why the wise bridesmaids could not share their oil with the others. Each one had to nurture their own spiritual lives in the same way that we care for our spiritual formation and faith development. It's impossible, hear me on this one, it is impossible to borrow spiritual reserves from another person. When all is said and done, you can tell someone about your relationship with Jesus Christ and how your faith helps you through the tough times of life. But you cannot implant your faith into the life of another person. The Holy Spirit must work in their lives to plant that seed of faith and to nurture it through disciplined study, worship, prayer, and loving Christian service. It all has to happen with them and the Holy Spirit. In his novel, A Mass for the Dead, writer William Gibson tells about the day he was tidying up his parents' home after both of them had passed away. Well, spotting his mother's gold-trimmed spectacles and favorite Bible on her bedside table, Gibson carefully put on the glasses and sat down in his mother's favorite chair by the window to just see what threads of faith he could uncover in the Bible. Try as hard as he might, the writer could not recapture any of her faith. In the end, Gibson admitted that he felt as silly as he must have looked wearing his mother's small glasses. And as far as his mother's faith was concerned, the author realized that her faith could not be borrowed. While it could serve as a good example for him and for others, it could never be transplanted in his heart or in his soul. Beloved, just like any other type of discipline in our lives, we cannot borrow someone else's faith to improve our own. It requires an investment on our part from the beginning to the very end. We must invest time, discipline, and devotion in our faith and spiritual formation if our lamps are to shine bright for a world in need. We can't borrow the reserves from others. But I can promise that this investment in our spiritual lives will pay off for all of us in blessings beyond measure as we encounter the crises and the struggles of life with a confident faith that can stand up to the tragedies, the storms, the pandemics, and other fears of life that come out, so our faith will come out stronger on the other end. It will strengthen our faith. Strengthen our faith. Perhaps that's why our Savior describes the bridesmaids with a faith-filled lamps as truly wise, since they have received divine wisdom through their faith to draw near to God for strength and renewal. For without that resilient faith, we end up moving through life like the foolish bridesmaids, fearful of what lies ahead and seeing little hope for the future as our spiritual lives run dry and many times spiral out of control. No doubt about it. Nurturing and strengthening our lives of faith will not be easy. It won't be easy, but still, through the power of the Holy Spirit, God will make it happen if we simply trust Him. But we've got to trust God with everything. And the benefits of refilling our spiritual lamps each day will truly be life-changing, guaranteed. For you see, beloved, if we are filling up our lamps every day with the steadfast faith of our Savior, our lives will have a different quality. We will have greater joy. We will have peace and satisfaction each day, regardless of the circumstances that are happening around us, because that joy, that peace, that satisfaction comes from Christ, not from the world. And in the end, it is that inner joy, peace, and satisfaction that awaits us at the door of life each day, when we enter God's presence with lamps that are filled to overflowing with divine faith and shining bright for His glory alone. So, how is your oil level today? How is my oil level? Better take a moment. Take a moment to check it before you finish this service. Check it. And then fill those lamps to the brim with the faith of Jesus Christ. If you need help, the owner's manual is right in front of you. It's a Bible. It's right in front of you, and the owner is sitting right beside you, ready to speak with you in prayer and fill up your lamp to overflowing with His amazing grace, love, and faith. In the name of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.